One of the most frequently asked questions to me is, how do you start your backswing? Well, the one thing you don't want to do, you don't want to start it from a dead stop, meaning you don't want to start up there like this, not move anything, and start just dead stop like this and just move it back. You want to have something in motion. There's lots of different ways to do it. But the two things I suggest you do are these. One, try to feel the weight of the club head, which maintains a light grip pressure. You may just lift the club up and just allow your right wrist to hinge a little bit like this. You can do what Mike Weir does and actually preview your backswing, and he takes it back like this and comes back there and comes back. That's actually a preview of the backswing. Lots of different other ones. You look at Gary Player. Gary Player will kick the right knee in like this, which allows him to start his hip turned back and his shoulder turned back together like this. Jack Nicklaus, he just turns his head to the right like this to clear his right shoulder so he can make a nice, long, full backswing. In my case, what I do, I just get the club up, make a few waggles like this, and then hit it. At this point in Lessons of a Lifetime, let's break down the entire golf swing, starting with the takeaway. A long time ago, I read an article about Arnold Palmer saying that the first 2 feet of the backswing is the most important part of the swing. This is what happens in the backswing. You start the club, left hand, left forearm, left shoulder, right hand is on for the ride. The left arm, the back of the left hand, take the club back for about the first 2 feet of the backswing like this. Notice that this arm, and the club doesn't move position. It moves, just moves back. That's called swinging the club back. What happens a lot of times is people lever the club back immediately with their hands, meaning that their hands go like this away from the ball. They either go around, up, but what happens, it makes the club very heavy in the golf swing. By doing this, the proper way, taking the club back for the first 2 feet without moving much of anything, now the club can go up and set properly with the hands. When you overuse the hands on the backswing, it can set early, it can unleash early, there are a lot of things that can go wrong. So let's review. Start of the takeaway, think of the back, the left hand, the last three fingers, the forearm, and the shoulder. They all move the club back in unison to about right there. That is the start of the takeaway. Another key element in the proper takeaway is the hands in, club head out. What you're doing here is this. You're maintaining this angle that the club shaft and your left arm make at address. You maintain that angle going back into your backswing about that far. That's the proper way of doing it. You don't want to break that angle and make that angle get straight like this. A lot of people will lift their hands up and then try to rotate around, or they'll immediately turn off the ball like this. Look, you've lost your angle. You've lost this angle. You want to maintain that angle deep into your backswing like this so that your hands can hinge properly at the top. That's swinging the club head. The proper takeaway is the hands in, the club head out. Now watch what happens in the backswing. It goes there like this. When it gets up to the top, your wrists break right up like this. And they're in a very, very perfect set position right here. The club is light. The left thumb is underneath the shaft. What happens when you rotate the club, where you get the club head in and the hands out, the club head starts here, 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 here. Now the club gets laid off, points over here, and it gets heavy up here with the left thumb on the side of the shaft like that, causing all kinds of problems in your golf swing inconsistency. So let's review. Hands in, club head out. What you're doing here is this. You're maintaining this angle that the club shaft and your left arm make at address, you maintain that angle going back into your backswing about that far. That's the proper way of doing it. Another key ingredient to a proper takeaway is the tempo of your takeaway. You must find your own body rhythm. I have a very fast, or pretty fast, takeaway. I take it away about that fast. Fred Couples, on the other hand, takes it away nice and slow. Now let's see how this works. The key things on the backswing are these. Don't forget, there's a sequence that happens. Your left arm, left hand, and left shoulder start the backswing, as we said before. The movement goes this way. The left arm, left shoulder, it goes this way like this, but watch what happens to the left knee. The left knee starts to collapse into the ball like this, and the right hip starts to turn out of the way backwards like this. The key element here is that it is a sequence, that your shoulders start your hip turn. Your shoulders start first, then your hips start, your hips are pulled by your shoulders on your backswing. The things we've got to stay away from are the straightening of the right knee in the backswing or the flexing outside the right foot of the right knee. Now watch what happens in a bad backswing. This is the dreaded reverse pivot, where the right knee straightens and your weight goes forward like this. Or the person who wants to get behind the ball, they slide this way and the right knee gets off the ball this way like that. We don't want to do that. What we want to do is continue the sequence on the backswing, which is left arm, left shoulder, club head starts this way, the left knee collapses in toward the ball, the right hip goes back, we get the club up in a proper position like that. That's how we transition into the backswing to the top of it. Another important point in consistency for your backswing is to maintain the angle of your left wrist all the way through to the top of the golf swing. Look, I have a slight break in that angle right there. It's not this way, and it's not this way. It's not cupped, and it's not convex like this. I want to take this angle of that left wrist up to the top of the backswing and keep it the same. It goes back there, it doesn't change. It goes up there like this, it doesn't change. At the top of the swing, it's the same angle like this. And when it starts down, it still remains the same angle. What happens in a lot of golf swings is that this angle on the backswing changes and it goes this way in the backswing, or it might go even cuppy and goes this way in the backswing. What happens to a lot of players is that that angle does not remain the same in the backswing. A lot of times when you take the club back with your hands too much, look where that angle is right now. It is dead flat. You've lost the cup. You've lost the cup on the backswing. You want to maintain that cup right to there in the backswing so that your hands hinge naturally. The way the club head will hinge the hands and keep that slight cup position right there at the top of the swing. Some people say they want a flat left wrist at the top of the backswing. I say you go to the top of the backswing with the same left wrist position as you started with at address. In continuing the discussion about the takeaway and the backswing, I placed a rod down here to show a reference point where you should be on the backswing. When you take the club away and your left arm reaches horizontal, when my left arm is parallel to the ground, I want the butt of the club to be aiming at that aim line right there. And on the mirror finish, on the follow through, when my right arm is straight, I want that butt of the club be also aiming right there at the aim line. That means I have made a complete release of the club head on a very concentric arc through the impact area. One of a couple of other ways to explain this is what I call the hitchhiker method. When you swing your club back, think about your thumbs. Your thumbs should be pointing just off vertical like this, and actually the club would then be, again, pointing toward that aim line right like that. On the follow-through, thumbs do the opposite. It's the mirror image of it, where the thumbs now point left of the vertical like this, and if you had the club in your hand, the butt of the club would actually be on your aim line again. Another way to describe this method is rotation of the forearms. Put your hands vertical like this, rotate your hands so they're horizontal like that. That's where they should be, somewhere in the backswing like this. A lot of people don't get it rotated enough. Some people rotate it too much. On the follow through, they rotate the other way like this. This is for slicers. When you don't rotate enough this way, the club never releases enough where the club face squares up at impact. It never gets to the point where the butt of the club points to your aim line. So you can think about it all three different ways. You can talk about on your backswing, left arm parallel, the club butt is pointed to the aim line, follow through, right arm straight, parallel, the butt is pointed to the aim line. You can talk about your thumbs. As you take it back, your thumbs go up like this. They're not vertical, they're not over here, they're like that. Follow through, they're not vertical, they're over like that. And you can also talk about it with your forearms rotating this way, the impact, and through like this. Remember, slicers go that way through impact. Well, in review of the backswing, let's take a look at the sequencing of it again. Remember at the beginning when I said you keep the weight in the balls of your feet? Well, one of the things in the backswing is your weight does not leave the balls of your feet. You transition around with your hips like this. You keep the weight centered along the balls of your feet like this in your backswing. It's centered there like this. You don't want your center of gravity to be moving back and forth like this. Number two, I remember one of the great tips I learned as a kid, and that is you want to turn your lower body in a barrel this way and then that way like this. You don't want to be sliding outside the walls of the barrel this way. You want to be turning in the barrel. Now let's review the whole backswing sequence to make sure that we have it down. We start our waggle, and remember, we start with our left hand, left arm, left shoulder. Remember, the angle of the shaft and the left arm stays consistent, keeping the club head outside the hands. As our shoulders turn, it also starts to turn our hips. The left knee starts to collapse in toward the ball. And what happens is our right hip is now turning backwards and getting out of the way. My left heel comes off the ground because I like to swing the club up a long way with my left arm. Then we transition up to the top. Right there, we're starting to feel a good tight pull in our back, especially the left side of our back. And what that does is create the torque that you need to create speed on the downswing. Now let's put it to practice and see what happens. And continuing our discussion about the golf swing, let's talk about the transition, defined as the change from the backswing to the downswing. I'm often asked two questions. One, what stops the backswing? And the other is, what starts a downswing? Well, the answer is the same. I mean, it's very simple. This is what happens. We have talked about what happens at the top of the backswing, where the club goes back, your shoulders, the club goes back, and you're starting to feel a real tension in your back, in your left side of your back right here, all the way down to your hip. That's the coiling action that we're talking about. We want that coiling action to create some tension there. And what happens is that before the backswing ends, watch my left heel. It goes down like this. That is called separation. What happens is that my lower body separates the turn from my upper body, which is still going back, and creates a little bit of a separation. My hips are a little bit in front of my shoulders now. That's the power move in golf that I think is essential to hitting the ball your maximum distance. All it takes is from there to here. And that allows me to whip on through the ball like that with my hands and arms. One of the keys to the proper transition is that your left shoulder, when it gets up to the top, does not straighten up this way. But it almost feels as if the left shoulder goes down like this, and then your arms come on through. But what you're doing is keeping your shoulders on the same plane. Remember, there and there. If you look at my left shoulder starts this way. It doesn't start that way. That's one of the killers that I see in a lot of golf swings. On the transition, people stand up, or they pull up. So let's review this. Your transition starts top of the swing, starts with the left heel down, left shoulder down, and from there, my good friend Jack Nicklaus said, you can go ahead and release the club with your right hand as hard as you want. Remember, grip pressure here is very important. If you have too tight a grip pressure, you'll go ahead and swing in front of the ball like this and hit it to the right. Gotta have nice, relaxed hands, and go ahead and throw that club head at the ball. Let's see if it works. Another question I get many times is, what do I look at when I'm hitting the golf ball? Well, it's pretty simple. I look at the point where I'm making contact with this golf ball, which is directly on this side of the golf ball in the center of it. And I'm looking at the ball. I'm squaring the club head up with the center of that back of the ball. That's where I look at. I look at that point and that point only. Now, a couple other points about the impact area. One from Sam Snead again, and the other one from my good friend Byron Nelson. Sam Snead said, start with the club at your starting position this way, take it up to the top, and then come down and stop right there. Try it again. Take it up to the top, come back and stop. My good friend Byron Nelson also had a wonderful tip about the impact position. He said when he was playing his best, his hips and his elbows were very, very close at impact. So when he took the club back and he went like this into the ball, his elbows and hips were close. They weren't out this way, they weren't out this way, but they were close to his body. In fact, he said he wore out the right side of his pants because his right elbow hit the right side of his pants all the time. That keeps the club face in line through the impact area. Now remember this about the impact position. What we try to do is establish a lot of constants in our golf swing so that the bottom of our arc is always forward of the center. What we're trying to do is catch the ball at the beginning of the bottom of the arc. The bottom of the arc is just ahead of the ball. Our goal is to consistently get the bottom of the arc at the same place on the ground every time we swing the golf club. We've talked about the impact position, but now let's talk about the follow-through to the finish. Now, there isn't any time really to think about this, but there are a couple things that you can do to effectively get in the right position on the follow-through. One of the things is a tried and true tip that used to use a handkerchief and now we use a towel. Put that under your left armpit there, and what the whole idea is to hold it there throughout the entire swing. Now, this has been used by Sam Snead, this has been used by Vijay Singh, but it's really one of those things that really helps keep you tied in this way. Keep that close to your chest, that's the main thing. Another good tip comes from my mentor, Stan Thirsk. With beginners in particular, he gets the club in their hands and he makes them do just half swings, back where the left arm is the parallel and the right arm is parallel like this. What really helps in the follow through is just to swing it back to parallel like this with your left arm with the club pointing up in the air. Remember, on that aim line there, and just swing it back again with the right arm straight and the club pointing to the aim line. But he makes the pupils go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth like this. It promotes the proper release going through. It keeps this part of the arm close to your chest as you're hitting it. Hips and elbows close together at impact. Like Byron Nelson said, and then when I was 6 years old, Dad said, all right, son, when you finish your golf swing, finish with your belt buckle facing the hole this way. One last tip. See if you can raise your right foot off the ground when you're in the follow-through position like this. That'll help you get to the final position, and you'll be a better golfer because of it. Talked a lot about the golf swing and the mechanics of it, but let's put the glue to the golf swing. What ties it all together? Well, it's rhythm, of course. You have to have a consistent rhythm to be a great golfer. You look at different golfers, they have different rhythms. You look at myself, I have a fast rhythm. Nick Price. Patrick Harrington. Then you look at Ernie Els and Fred Couples. They have very slow rhythms. The best rhythm I probably ever saw was Sam Snead. He had a rhythm that he called oily. He wanted to have his swing nice and oily. Remember, light grip pressure. Light grip pressure was the key. Sam, as he took that long waggle like that and turned his head. Nice, smooth rhythm. Usually a very good success. I have another idea, and I've learned this from a friend who sent me by letter a long time ago. He said, rhythm can be defined as thinking of the word Edelweiss in your golf swing. Now, Edelweiss sounds kind of goofy, but really, if you think about it, everybody has a certain rhythm to their golf swing. Now, if I'm taking a cut at the golf ball and I swing Edelweiss like that, that's my rhythm. Now, some people's Edelweiss may be faster or slower than my Edelweiss, but I like the term Edelweiss because it gives you a rhythm with which you can swing the golf club consistently. Edelweiss. Could be Edelweiss. It could be Edelweiss. Now sometimes Edelweiss doesn't work. Sometimes you have to go to extreme measures. Those measures have to do with the feel of a golf club. Sometimes we just simply lose the feel of a golf club. A lot of that has to do with grip pressure. We're gripping on too tight or we're walking too fast. One of the great stories about Byron Nelson. Byron said when he got under pressure, he always walked too fast. And he said, Tom, do two things. Walk a little slower and breathe a little deeper. But there's another thing you can do. When the heat's on, the club doesn't feel like there's anything in your hand, do this. Take the club, and instead of taking the club and swinging it with that end of it on, turn it over and swing the club with just the grip end. Now, if you're really in bad shape, you're going to go like that because it's so light that you can't control the impact area. Remember, coming back to the impact, go back, swing it nice and slow like this, 3 or 4 times. Then turn it over. Now the club head feels like it's a ton. Now, light grip pressure, take a couple of practice swings with it. Man, that feels like it's... Now I can feel the club head. And the last thing I want to share is how hard should you swing the golf club? The key here is how hard you should swing the golf club and keep it in rhythm. Some players can feel like they can swing it close to 90 to 95% and keep it in rhythm. Other people, they lose their balance just a little bit, so they shouldn't go quite that hard. But as a general rule, I like to say swing about 90 to 95% when you feel like you're in good balance with your driver, and with your other clubs, maybe 85 and 90%. You can create a good rhythmic type of golf swing if you keep it under control. Put a little bit of a governor on it so you don't always want to try to hit the ball as hard as you can. We have focused on the important fundamentals of the golf swing, as I understand them. All the things that must be constant in your swing. Now we move to the variations on the theme, hooks, slices, etc. But before you move to the following lessons, be very sure you understand and can apply the basic fundamentals we've already covered. I'm standing on the 17th tee at the Old White Course at the Greenbrier. It's one of my favorite places. Now, this tee is a par 5 tee, but I'm going to demonstrate here the use of the hybrid. Now, I had some pretty good success with the hybrid in the 2009 British Open. I only hit it 25 times during the entire tournament. That's a lot to be using one club.
Only perfect.
I used this particular hybrid right here, which is an 18-degree hybrid, and that's the same loft as a 2-iron. Now, I don't have a 2-iron anymore in my bag, and thankfully so, because there's a lot of different things you can do with a hybrid that you can't do with the old blade 2-iron. I'm going to demonstrate here, just simply off the tee, how you use the hybrid. Or the first thing you have to do, you have to tee it up the right height. I tee it up just about a quarter inch to a half inch above the ground level, like this. I basically play the ball forward to center because I want to catch this ball right at the bottom of my arc. I don't want to be catching it down or up like a driver, down like an iron or up like a driver. I want to catch it right at the bottom of my arc. I've established the bottom of my arc is just inside my left heel right here, and that's where I try to position the ball, and that's where I want to hit the ball on the downswing. The reason I use the hybrid off the tee is very simple. There's a lot more margin for error than hitting a long iron off the tee. The sweet spot on the hybrid is larger and more forgiving. So why not use a club that gets you in less trouble, gets you out to your maximum distance easier than a long iron? Basically, everything I'm doing right here is to make this shot very easy to hit and very hard to miss hit. Now, say we're in the fairway. I don't do much different off the fairway than I do off the tee, with the exception I play the ball back probably about a half inch because I want to make sure I hit the balls just slightly on the downswing when the ball is sitting on the ground. So I move the ball back in my stance slightly. And again, I make the same swing as I did off the tee, but just move the ball back slightly. See, I took a divot there. I wanted to make sure I hit down on the ball and catch the ball slightly in the downswing. That's what you do when the ball's sitting on the short grass. Now, where the hybrid really shines is out of the rough. It's really easy to get the ball up out of the rough with a hybrid compared to a long iron. A lie like this, you can see the ball pretty well, but it's sitting down enough where a 2-iron out of this, you'd have a very hard time getting the ball up in the air because you cannot make a very good contact with a 2-iron off that lie. But with a hybrid, with its perimeter weighting, you can hit down on the ball right here and get the ball up out of that lie a lot easier than a long iron or a 2-iron. I address the ball in the rough like this, essentially the same as I do from the fairway. I want to catch the ball slightly on the downswing, so I play it a little bit farther back than I do when the ball's on the tee. Again, out of the rough, it's a lot easier to hit. Ball gets up, and not a problem. Try a hybrid. It's an easy club to hit. We have now covered all shots involved in approaching the green. Before we get to putting, we thought it might be useful to provide a pictorial review of the full swing. Since we don't get a lot of wind here at the Greenbrier because it's in the beautiful valleys of the Allegheny Mountains, we've had to create our own wind. Now I'm going to teach you how to hit a full shot at the wind. Just like we did with the putting, we're going to use these machines to simulate some wind. All right, Maestro. Essentially, when I'm playing the ball into the wind, I want to keep the ball lower, but I also want it swing easier. to hit the ball lower. We've talked about that earlier on, where I get my left shoulder a little bit lower, my right shoulder a little higher, and play the ball back of my stance. The other thing is that I want to swing easier. I do not want to really hit this very hard. That means that I might take one, two, three, maybe even four more clubs to hit this ball. Let's see what happens. That's the normal position. And now I've taken my low ball position. Left shoulder lower, right shoulder higher. Lift the club up. And that's the way you control the ball in a heavy wind.
With a chance for eagle.
The most commonly asked question to me is, how do you stop the slice? Everybody seems like they slice the ball and they want a solution. Well, there are several things I tell them. The first thing I look at is the grip. A lot of people have the left thumb straight down the shaft. Simple solution. Move the hand over so you see the two knuckles. Even to the point where you see 2.5 knuckles or 3 knuckles with the left hand. Put the right hand on wherever it's comfortable and swing. A lot of times that's the only solution that's necessary for people who slice the ball, a poor grip. If they have a slice type of swing where the club head comes around and comes across, the handle leads the club head through like this, I tell them to do a couple things. First of all, grip pressure. We talked about grip pressure a lot. From the top of the golf swing, if you have light grip pressure, you can allow the club head to swing back into the ball. If you have tight grip pressure, you tend to pull the handle through the ball like this. The other thing I do, which you talked about before, is I want you to keep the inside of your left arm close to your chest at impact and rotate the left forearm through impact. Again, when you come through the impact area, keep it close in here, hips and elbows, like Byron Nelson said, and rotate this left forearm like this through the impact area until you're right in that position like this. If it keeps close to the chest, your centrifugal force will allow that club to rotate through like this. If not, it'll stay. If it gets away from the body like this, it stays away. Again, the handle leads the club head into the ball like this, and you slice the ball. So let's review this. Let's start off with the grip. If you have a weak grip, strengthen your left hand. At the top of the golf swing, on the way down, don't pull up. Start with the left shoulder coming down. And then keep this very close to your chest as you come into the impact and feel like the left forearm rotates through like this. That'll close the club face, square it up, and continue on through the shot like this. That's the way you correct a slice. I'm also asked, how do you stop hooking the ball? Remember what Trevino said. He said, you can talk to a slice, but you can't talk to a hook. Well, hook can really get away from you. And this is what you do. Make sure that the left hand is not in too strong a position. Move the left hand over. Make sure that you see the two knuckles there, or even maybe just one knuckle if you're really a bad hooker of the ball. Make sure that the right hand gets up on top like this. That prevents the club head from turning over really quickly through the impact area. The other thing that you do is that the top of the swing, the transition, you make a quicker transition with your left hip. This left hip moves quicker this way, and that keeps the club head delayed and not turning over. What commonly happens for a hook is that the leg stays too still on the downswing and the right shoulder comes around and the hands speed up too quickly. So this is how you do it. And that's how you stop a hook. Make sure that the left hand is not in too strong a position. Make sure that the right hand gets up on top. At the top of the swing, you make a quicker transition with your left hip. That keeps the club head delayed and not turning over.